Hey everyone, and welcome back to our channel. My name is Casey.
And I'm Anthony.
And we are Dos Cabazos, and this is the ending of Chernobyl, episode 5. This is the little documentary part at the end, and we're also including the portion in our episode 5 video that got muted for whatever reason.
Yeah.
This is going to be a shorter video than normal, but that's just because this is a little bit shorter.
Yeah. Pretty much wrapping up our Chernobyl, yeah. So this is going to be the last of our Chernobyl content.
Our Chernobyl stuff.
Starting tomorrow, we're going to be starting Better Call Saul Season 4, so keep an eye out for that. If you haven't already subscribed, please make sure to do so and hit that little bell so you can stay notified when we upload that video.
Yeah.
But let's check out this little documentary and let's just see if we can get a little bit more information on this.
Why worry about something that isn't going to happen?
Oh, that's perfect. They should put that on our money.
What's really interesting is how the ideology of the Soviet Union, the idea of a system that was infallible, and the fear of people to point out any flaws or mistakes, everything had to be perfect, and you had to pretend it was perfect. Any system with too strong an ideology, whether it's the idea of a perfect nation or a perfect belief, leads to exclusion of facts.
Scary when that happened.
The West is now satisfied that Chernobyl was solely the result of operator error, which it essentially was.
When you start to look at all the different causes of this accident to happen, it's the sort of accumulation of that kind of a mentality, which is it's more convenient to believe comfortable truths and comfortable facts than it is to have to face difficult choices and difficult realities.
It's time. Maybe a year.
Cherubina, he's confronted with his sense of mortality, that he's presented with that idea of what was his life worth and did it mean anything? Did he have an impact on this situation? Because he was a party man, because he was an insider, he knew how to get the machinery of the state to work.
God's sakes, Boris. You were the one who mattered most.
That's such a beautiful scene between them.
Who's been this very stubborn, recalcitrant person who refuses to accept any responsibility for what happened.
I wasn't in the room when they raised the power.
Anatoly Dyatlov made decisions no rational person should have ever made. He made crazy choices.
I haven't reviewed. We only just found out we're
there. Review it.
In the trial, Dyatlov historically does say the following thing. I will not say that I am guilty, but I cannot say that I am not. And I thought that was a remarkable expression of the, at least the potential of guilt. It was very Soviet in its own way, the statement, to have it both ways.
The trial is, as always, we want to find who's guilty. The people's lust for revenge, which is something really, really dangerous, it makes it very attractive to find scapegoats and throw as meat to the dogs.
Once it's over, we will have our villains, we will have our hero, we will have our truth.
We established pretty early on what mistakes did those people do in the control room. But the thing is that the system was guilty.
Professor Legasov, if you mean to suggest the Soviet state is somehow responsible for what happened, then I must warn you, you are treading on dangerous ground.
That is how an RBMK reactor core explodes. Lies.
So that was the inside the episode for episode 5 of Chernobyl. It was really interesting when we saw the episode, the whole thing with Dyatlov. We knew that he was responsible, but I did not know to the severity of negligence that he actually took place that during that those course of events at that night. Was really ridiculous to watch. But, I mean, you know, it's such a weird situation because in the back of his mind, he always thought, like, hitting that switch is, like, you know, the fail-safe in that sense. That, like, if I screwed up everything that could possibly be screwed up and we still push that button, then we'd still be okay. So he just pretty much took it to the point where, like, oh, yeah, well, if that's going to be my fail-safe, then I could do whatever the hell I want.
Yeah.
At least that's how I took it.
I feel like it's crazy for the actors that play these characters, like, to just get into the mindset of that, you know? And I feel like a lot of times in shows in general, that, you know, the actors, they kind of explain more into the character, and I feel like they would know a lot about it because they're the ones having to portray it.
Yeah.
So I always find it interesting, like in this one where they gave us kind of like the actor's perspective about the character, but in this case it was a real person. Yeah. So that's like a whole new interesting dynamic. So
yeah, it's crazy when you have to put yourself in, it's not just like, you know, words on the paper, it's actually the people that actually existed and stuff. Mm-hmm. So it's always an interesting, always really interesting to see how people portray a certain character, I would say.
So we didn't watch any of the other Inside the episodes, and we wanted to do it just for the last one, just because it was the last one. And, you know, it was short, but I feel like it's interesting to see the people who made this and what their thoughts are, and you can see their passion for it. And it's always nice to just get a little bit of extra inside information about what you're watching. So, yes, it's crazy that Chernobyl, we're officially done with it. And
it went by so quick. Yeah. Five episodes was so
but
quick
it,
to
it
go
like,
through.
I don't know. I just feel like
something's missing now for me.
Yeah,
like it's just like it just
like,
went
okay,
by so quickly.
Well, I guess
obviously,
that's
it'd
done.
Be hard to sit through and watch more emotional heart wreck. But it was so good the way they did it, which we've talked about at length throughout our entire reactions for all five of these episodes. How well this was done, masterfully so. The dynamics between Skarsgård and Harris, they were just beautiful. Like that one scene when he was pretty much telling him that like you meant everything.
Yeah.
You did so much. That was just really kind of like it really tugged on the heartstrings how much their friendship and their bond kind of grew through these horrible and tragic events.
All right, so now here is our epilogue of episode 5, the one that got muted in our previous video. So, hope you enjoy!
Wow. Larry Lagossip took his own life at the age of 51 on April 26, 1988, exactly 2 years after the explosion at Chernobyl. Oh, wow. That was really him. Audio tapes of Lagossov's memoirs were circulated among the Soviet scientific community. His suicide made it impossible for them to be ignored. Yeah, in the aftermath of his death, Soviet officials finally acknowledged the design flaws of the RBMK nuclear reactor. The reactors were retrofitted to prevent an accident like Chernobyl from happening again. Was aided by dozens of scientists who worked tirelessly alongside him at Chernobyl. Some spoke out against the official account of events and were subject to denunciation, arrest, and imprisonment. The character of Ulana Komyuk was created to represent them all and to honor their dedication and just, oh wow, it's the truth and humanity. She represented. Boris Shcherbina died on August 22nd, 1990.
He lived a couple more years after.
4 years and 4 months after he was sent to Chernobyl. Wow, that was done together. For their roles in the Chernobyl disaster, Victor.
Yeah,
Liv Nikolai.
So 10 years.
10 years earlier. Wow. After his release, Nikolai Fomin returned to work. Nuclear power in Russia. Wow.
I honestly thought that they would be killed.
Tiatlov died from radiation related illness in 1995. 64. That was him.
Yeah.
Budmichuk's body was never recovered. He is permanently entombed. Oh my gosh. Oh wow, that's horrible. Firefighters' colleague still remains in the basement of the Pripyat hospital, still dangerously radioactive. So, wow.
58.
Oh
64.
My gosh. The daughter Ludmila suffered multiple strokes. Doctors told her she would never be able to bear a child. So did she really? Husband and daughter. Okay. Oh man. They were wrong? Did she have another child? Oh my gosh! Oh wow! Who watched from the railway bridge, it has been reported that none survived. Yeah. The bridge of death.
You mentioned
I've
that
heard
in the first
of
episode,
before.
That term.
400 miners worked around the clock for 1 month to prevent a total nuclear meltdown. It is estimated that at least 100 of them died before the age of 40. Oh my gosh. Around the clock for 1 month.
Yeah.
It has been widely reported that the three divers who drained the bubbler tanks died as a result of their... Okay. All three survived!
Two are still alive!
Oh, that's... Oh, wow! I'm sad for the one who's not still alive, though. 600 people were constructed to serve in the exclusion zone. Despite widespread accounts of sickness and death as a result of radiation, the Soviet government kept no official records.
Tiny region of Ukraine, large known as the exclusion zone, ultimately encompassed 2,600 square kilometers. It's so eerie to look at.
300,000 people were displaced from their homes. They were told this was temporary.
Look at that. That looks so...
It's just overgrown and it is still forbidden to return. It looks like... Oh my gosh, it's just insane. Gorbachev presided over the Soviet Union until its dissolution in 1991. 2006, he wrote, "The nuclear meltdown at Chernobyl was perhaps the true cause of the collapse of the Soviet Union."
Whoa.
Wow. 2017, work was completed on the new safe confinement at Chernobyl at a cost of nearly $2 billion. It's designed to last 100 years. So then they have to redo it? Wow. With the explosions, there was a dramatic spike in cancer rates across Ukraine and Belarus.
Aww.
Oh. Oh my gosh.
Their immunities, I mean, I don't know if that was it, but like maybe they were just weaker.
Maybe because they were pregnant. We will never know the actual human cost of Chernobyl. Most estimates range from...
Wow, that's a very big...
Wow, 4,000 like, to 93,000 deaths. That's a huge range. The official Soviet death toll unchanged since 1987. Is that the reactor in the hand?
It's 31.
31? Oh my gosh. They're not even honoring the dead? Not even with an accurate number? Or a somewhat accurate memory of all who suffered and sacrificed?
All right, everyone. So thank you again for watching. Thank you for going on this journey with us. Mm-hmm. I know most of you have probably already seen it prior to us watching it, but thank you for watching it with us and seeing us emotionally damaged from the series. But in all honesty, it's probably one of my favorite miniseries mm-hmm. that I've ever seen. It's just, like we talked about at length, so well done. But as I stated at the beginning of our video too, please don't forget to like and subscribe. Hit that little bell so you can stay notified. We'll be going to be doing Better Call Saul this month. As soon as Walking Dead starts up at the end of this month, we're going to be Walking Dead as well. Next month, we're going to be doing Ozark.
And then Last Kingdom at some point here out. Soon.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And whenever they decide to release that one, I think Netflix just kind of just drops it a few weeks before like the season starts and be like, here you go.
Anticipated for the spring, so I'm hoping for the spring. So we'll see.
All right, guys. Like I said, if you want to stay notified for all those future videos, hit that bell, and we'll catch you next time.
Bye.
Bye.